Good morning, everybody. My name is Sean Quincy. I'm the Public Information Officer for this event. To be clear, this is the 10:30 news conference for the public safety power shutoff event as it affects Humboldt County. Today, we are here to give you an update on the current situation and the activities that various county agencies and public first responders are doing to help our citizens get through this incident. We have Sherri Honsal here. We have Dr. Baird, Amy Nielsen, County Administrative Officer, and other first responders here to help answer any questions. And with that, I'll hand it over to Sherri Honsal.
Great, thank you, Sean. Appreciate it. Good morning and welcome, everyone. The last 48 hours has been very, very fluid when it comes to the public safety power shutoffs that we've been notified of. As of yesterday, we were not even being considered as a public safety power shutoff area. We were notified by PG&E that neighboring counties were going to be affected, and yesterday morning we got notified that there was a possibility that we were going to get power shut off, and the likelihood was growing as the day stretched on. That was due to the red flag warnings that the National Weather Service predicted for our area. And just remind people too, red flag warning was not initially a part of Humboldt County. It was going to be a part of Mendocino, Shasta County. And because of the events that are occurring in Shasta County, PG&E elected to de-energize the transmission lines that that basically deliver power to Humboldt County. And they notified us that 60,000 customers were going to be without power yesterday. We've been trying to work with PG&E to try to get some information to solidify what exactly that meant. It really took us all day to verify the fact that power was initially shut off, because we do have some independent power plants here in the county, Humboldt Bay power plants there at King Salmon. We also have some biomass power plants within our county that do power certain portions of the grid. But for the overall grid security, they elected to shut down all those power sources and to leave 60,000 customers without power as of 1:20 last night. We've done our best to work with that public information to push it out to people about this power outage. And PG&E has let us know that they're doing their best to restore power as quickly as they possibly can. We don't have an estimate right now of when that power could be come back on. So we're telling people, just like PG&E is, prepare for at least a day, possibly 2 days of working without power. Again, this is just a power outage. This is not a local emergency. We do not have a local emergency event like a wildfire or an earthquake. This is a power outage. Now, it has made a huge impact on the economy here, on personal services, on the gas, groceries, sending kids to school. We recognize that, we understand that. The information that we're receiving in the county, we know, is vital when someone's trying to plan their day or trying to plan their next action, especially those that are part of our vulnerable population. We are very, very sensitive to that. That's why our public health director is here, Dr. Baird. He will be addressing those things in a few minutes. We also have Amy Nielsen, our CAO for the county, and she'll be talking about the continuity of our government, how our government's pushing forward despite the power outage. And we also have Billy Reynolds from Humboldt Bay Fire, talk about public safety aspects and things, if you have any questions about that, and also Kurt McCray from CAL FIRE. We take this very serious. We want to make sure that that information is disseminated to people. I think it's very, very important that everyone is kept up to speed on it. That's why we are advising people to get the latest information. It's coming from PG&E. So if you want to go to their website, they have their maps out when the populated areas are affected, what their anticipated restoration times are, and that is the information that's coming and will be coming as quick as possible, as soon as they can put it out there. We have activated our Office of Emergency Services. It is activated. We have brought in several public safety partners and members of our emergency management team to deal with this event that is occurring throughout the county. So we're doing our best to stay on top of things and to disseminate that information. information and to respond to the emergency. So far, knocking on wood, things have been managed, and all public safety services are still operational. We're urging people to call 911 only when there's an actual emergency. We do not want people to tax the public safety answering systems asking questions about restoration of power. That is not our job. We have no control over that, and we don't have that information to give you. We're going to refer you to PG&E. If you do have general questions, we have set up a Facebook page, our Office of Emergency Services. Go to our Facebook page with the county, and we can answer some of those questions. You can see some of that latest information on there, what we have, so you have that. We also have sent out a Humboldt Alert message. So if you haven't signed up for Humboldt Alert, it's our way of mass notification of different information out to the citizens of Humboldt County. If we get information that's vital to Humboldt County, we'll be pushing out through Humboldt Alert. You'll get it on your email, your cell phone, your home phone, voice, text, whatever you sign up for. To our knowledge, most of of our critical infrastructure besides power is operational. So we're doing our best to make sure that is up to speed. And I understand there are several grocery stores that are down now because of lack of power. Gas stations, we're also going to be taking a list of the gas stations that are open, and also supermarkets that are open, to push that out to people so they know where to buy food, where to buy gas. It's important for everyone to have that information there. We are still in this general area under a red flag warning. So we want people to be cautious. All burns and prescribed burns have been, I think, suspended at this time. We want people to report if they see a fire, to report it immediately to 911 so we can investigate, so we can send them much resources out there. It's important that we get on top of this quickly. Also, people that are towing vehicles, make sure you're towing vehicles that aren't dragging chains, that you're not throwing lit cigarettes in the material out of a moving vehicle. Those are the ways that fires really get going here in the county in this area. The wind is still an issue here in the county. And so we want to make sure we mitigate as much possibility of a fire danger here in the county as possible. It's important to know that PG&E is doing what they can to mitigate some of the issues with this event. They're going to actually open a community resource center this afternoon, located at Redwood Acres. And I'll refer you to PG&E's website and information regarding that. But they want to open this community resource center to aid people in getting out of the heat, to charge a cell phone, those kind of things. It's not going to be a shelter where people can stay at. It's a temporary location that they can get some resources, they can get a charge, that would also happen. I understand that they're trying to work on something called the Redwoods, and Humboldt Bay Fire also is working on a place to charge a cell phone. So we are going to continue to have our Office of Emergency Services activated, and I urge people to again look at that website, look at our Facebook page to get the latest information. And as soon as we have information, we'll be pushing that out. At this time, talk about our most vulnerable population. I'd like to have Dr. Baird come up and talk about what the county and our public health department is doing to assist those that need care.
Good morning. Our concern is indeed for the most vulnerable, and I want to commend our local hospitals, all of which have generators, our local skilled nursing facilities, all have generators that are operational. Our other partners, Senior Resource, ACE, Home Health Nursing, public health field nurses are backfilling many positions to help actually make home visits to those people. We're trying to avoid unnecessary trips to the emergency room so we don't overwhelm services for critical injuries. We are in communication with our regional and state resources if this extends longer than anticipated, for additional supplies, fuel, generators, ambulances if necessary. But our local paramedics, EMTs are operational as usual. We have sufficient ambulances and air transport for critical emergencies that can be handled locally. The important thing is to stay home. If you don't need to go out, be safe, particularly with propane and generators. Alternative sources careful because you may not be used to these devices. Take care of your neighbors for food, for safety. And if you have an operational generator, share the power. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Barrett. And we're going to have time for questions, you know, after this, after our initial statements. I'd like to call our CAO, Amy Nelson, up to talk about our community government.
Thank you. The public should know that a few years ago, the county undertook some continuity of government and continuity of operations planning. And so the county of Humboldt has these plans and is now relying on these plans to help us determine which essential services should be implemented. And because we have a lack of power in the courthouse, and we want to conserve the power that we do have, we are shutting down many of the administrative functions in the courthouse in order to keep the jail as operational as we can. Some of the county offices that are closed are all county libraries, the clerk reporter, UC Cooperative Extension, the treasurer tax collector, the auditor's office, the clerk of the board, the assessor is closed to the public, the county administrative office, and human resources is closed to the public. There are county offices that do remain open. The county commercial airport in McKinleyville is open. Probation, Maine on Harrison is open, and drug court has limited operations. Planning in Redway is open. However, planning at the Clark Complex is open, but they are not doing inspections. The courts are partially operational. Health and Human Services, the Public Health Lab is open, Department of Environmental Health, Public Health Nursing. The Social Services offices are closed at Koster. CWS, however, is open, including the emergency response function. Mental Health is open for vital services, Semper Virens and the Crisis Stabilization Unit. And same day services. There is a doctor on staff at 720 Wood Street for the Clark Complex. County Council's office is also open and doing court hearings. And the district attorney is operating in court, but the district attorney's offices are closed to the public on the fourth floor. And Sheriff Patrol remains fully staffed and stable. And county employees should know that the auditor and payroll staff are working on county payroll, and county payroll should be able to be issued this coming Friday.
Billy Reynolds, Humboldt Bay Fire. Chief, you want to come up and
Hi, so fortunately for us, we did see a spike in activity last night when the power did first go out. Fire alarms started going off and whatnot. Since then, it's been relatively calm, so we've had normal activity during the day. As it stretches into the second day, though, we want to stress with residents out there, as people are using generators, as people are going to their second night of darkness with candles, being hypervigilant about if you are leave a candle unattended, you need to make sure you put that candle out. If you're operating the generator, you're exercising safe practices, such as making sure that it's not operating in an area where you would see carbon monoxide become an issue. And you're using alternative sources of heat, such as wood fuel and whatnot, making sure that you're being vigilant about chimney fires and other hazards. One other thing to mention, keeping this very brief, as Sheriff Honsal mentioned, we are going to be opening, in cooperation with the Department of Health and Human Services, an interim charging station at our fire department classroom at 3030 L Street here in Eureka. And that'll be available for, again, for people to come. It's not a shelter, but to come and charge phones, medical devices, get some water. And it'll be staffed by personnel from the Department of Health and Human Services. So that's at 3030 L Street here in Eureka, directly underneath the water tower. Thanks.
And we have Chief Cray here from CAL FIRE. Chief.
Good morning, thank you. I'd like to first of all thank all the departments within the county government for their cooperation and attention to this event. We do not have an emergency. Fire activity has been very low statewide in the last 24 hours. However, we are prepared for this event. We will stay prepared for this event, which we expect will last through Friday. In the preparation, we've augmented our staffing. We brought on additional equipment as well as augmented our aircraft resources throughout Northern California. So the real test for us is going to be the next 48 to 72 hours. At this time, we have no emergencies, and we just look forward to getting through this with the diligence and care by the public in preventing wildfire. Thank you.
Thank you, Chief McRae. I think it's important to also highlight here that, you know, I think one thing this is revealing is that we're very, very dependent on PG&E and PG&E power. I think one thing that we do have to say is Humboldt County, as we pull out of this, is look at ways of being self-sufficient on our power grid. And as we move forward, because two transmission lines coming into the county, if something goes wrong with that, it takes out the whole county power. That is an issue, that is a problem. And so we will be working with our local governments to see how we can improve that in the future. I think people need to take time, you know, as we are in Humboldt County, to prepare for events like this. Again, if you don't have an emergency going on, it's a power outage, to make sure that we'll be prepared next time in the event that there is a massive earthquake or there is a wildfire, and we have to respond to the actual emergency and deal with the power outage, deal with infrastructure loss. And so I think it's important that we take lessons learned and then move on from there. I'm very, very appreciative of the collaboration that the Sheriff's Office in the county has right now, working with Humboldt Bay Fire, Eureka Police Department, all the city governments, CAL FIRE, our Department of Health and Human Services, and Public Health Director. Everyone has been great, including State Office of Emergency Services that have personnel here. Also, Allison Talbot from PG&E has been checking in, and I appreciate her and the information that she's been giving us. And so we will be working together, again, to collaborate to try to get as much information out to the public as possible, because we know it's important for you. So at this point in time, I'd like to open up for questions, one at a time.
Amy, you mentioned that the airport is open. Are flights in and out unaffected so far?
There were some delays this morning, but the remainder of the flights have been unaffected.
We heard something about, I think the chief said something about Friday. Is that like some kind of estimate or something?
Yeah, so the National Weather Service, they have estimated that the red flag warning will be finished or over at 11 a.m. on Thursday. Now, work with PG&E, they can't just put the switch back on once the weather event is over. They have to inspect the transmission lines. And that is only done in our rural area through helicopter. And so they're going to have to go ahead and fly those transmission lines to ensure that all of them are operational before they flip that power switch on. So that's something that they will be working on, and that's something that's, that will be hopefully working with PG&E, knowing when those helicopters are in the air, when that may occur. So we're hoping that it occurs more soon than later, but like I said, we're preparing for that 48 hours. So there's, I just got reminded, there's 18,000 miles of lines here that they have to inspect. So there's a lot of lines out there that they have to look at. But I'm getting assurances that there's not just one helicopter that will be flying, there's multiple helicopters, and they're going to do it as quick as possible. So as soon as they're able to. Now there's high winds and ridges, you know, that may prevent helicopters from flying. And again, it has to be weather conditions to actually restore the lines before they're actually able to do that. So
this is probably a question for PG&E, but were any of you informed why the efforts to get to that Humboldt Bay Power plant to power the local customers was unsuccessful?
They did not tell us the specific reasons why they could not energize the lines with the local power plant, other than they don't have the capability of doing that at this time. But they hope to remedy this after this event.
All right, if there's no further questions, you guys, we're gonna plan to send out another update with updated information, hopefully around 3 o'clock or so today. Make sure to stay tuned to the County Office of Emergency Services Facebook and Twitter pages for the latest updates, and make sure to contact PG&E for updates with PG&E. Thank you, everybody, for coming.
Thank you.